As far as I know, this particular place that we're at, in the southeastern corner of the reserve, quarantine enjoys this particular area. That's a beautiful shot of his face there. For those of you who are adapted, new to leopard ID, the spot patterns that you're seeing on the face, in particular above the whiskers and behind the nose, are like a fingerprint. Now, he looks a bit hungry, I must be honest with you. His belly is a little bit hollow. He doesn't look in bad condition, not at all. What a fantastic animal. Bushbuck still barking away behind us. I'm going to turn our vehicle around, follow him. Being a bit hungry, he's not skinny, but being a bit hungry, he will hunt a little bit deeper into the day than he would normally do if he was full. They've got quite a high metabolic rate. Leopard need to eat on average every 3 to 4 days, but do eat actually on average only once every 10 to 12 days. Can you believe it? That's on average over a whole year. Leopard and lion have been researched in the Kruger National Park for decades, and some crazy researchers have collared and follow around leopard pretty much daily in some areas of the reserve, 24 hours a day for months at a time. Stations, we've relocated this young male, Ingwe. He's mobile north off of Mamba on the western side of the drainage line. Go with you on the message. We've just got an update on Twitter, and thank you very, very much for your help. Is that we've positively identified him as quarantine. Watch this spider here. So some of you who are a bit new to leopard biology might be wondering how, of all the leopard that we could be seeing in an area, we know that this could be one of two cats. And it's same bushbuck that he keeps on hunting. I wonder if there's not two leopard in this area. Because the bushbuck are coming from in front of us and from a different area, not next to where we've got so I'm wondering if there's not another predator in this area that's contributing to the confusion that these bushbuck are seeing. Now, it's not common to see bushbuck in this area. They're actually quite rare to see. Here we go, bushbuck jumping. Very, very close to where we last saw quarantine. Now, an adult male bushbuck like that is a formidable foe. They're not the easiest things to take down. They're incredibly powerful. You saw those big horns. Incredibly sharp, needle tipped. And quarantine, being a young cat, may not have the courage just yet to tackle a full grown male bushbuck. Hence
the lack of conviction that we're seeing from him to chasing it down. Now, the last time I saw him, he was in that bush on the right-hand side of your screen, probably 50 feet from where we are right now. I've got a funny feeling he's probably gone to ground there. Leopard have a tendency just to go down into a preemptive strike pose, which is on their haunches quite low down. I didn't want to get involved in the hunt, which is why I switched off the car and we just stopped. We in no way want to try and influence a hunt in either way, either in the bushbuck's favour or in the leopard's favour. The bushbuck has moved off across the drainage line. We're definitely getting more alarm calls of bushbuck all around us, so my gut feel still tells me that we've got more than one cat in this area. Now, with the bushbuck having moved away from this leopard, and typically leopard only really hunting anywhere from about 5 to 30 meters, I'm fairly certain that we won't be influencing any hunting. We're going to try and pick him up again before we lose him. Bushbuck in front of us. Although we've got this big drainage line, which is actually where I'd expect quarantine to be. Using whatever cover they can, it's very difficult for us to drive inside there. So I'm going to go to where we've got the bushbuck. The bushbuck is in front of us and a nyala. So we've got a male bushbuck and some nyala. Nyala, although nyala will feature in the prey of leopard, definitely the bushbuck is what he'd probably be aiming at. That nyala is a little bit too big for him. That nyala is probably weighing in at roughly 100 kilograms. Whereas that young male leopard was probably no more than 30 or 40 kilograms. The stations, we've lost visual of this. My daughter Ingwe last seen mobile north away from Mamba along the western edge of the drainage line. That's a bull nyala that you were just having a look at over there. Horns, female nyala don't have horns and they're also a more rusty color. The bushbuck that we saw was in front of the nyala. Now, the only thing that I'm seeing around is Franklin. I'm fairly certain. See if we can't follow where those nyala came from. Through there is the bushbuck. You can see bushbuck's making his way back actually where he came from. Well, we'll do. See if we can just switch off a little bit. It worked for us once. There's no reason to believe why it won't work for us again. He is obviously quite hungry. There are animals in the prey weight size that he has right here. There's a lot of cover. I have no doubt that he's still in the area. We're just going to give it one or two more minutes just to see if he comes popping out of the woodwork once those nyala have moved off a little bit. And then what we'll do is we'll hug the drainage line back towards the road. We'll see if we can pick him up there. I can hear another squirrel giving an alarm call. Ahead of us. Now that could either be the other predator, or it could be him. We're definitely going to investigate in one more minute. Have a look there. So that's the bush bike that you're hunting. Bring it forward a little bit. You see that's an adult male bush buck. Don't see them very often in the open like that. He is going straight back to where we last saw quarantine. For that reason, I'm not going to move right now. I know we've got squirrels calling about 300-400 yards in front of us. We've got this bush buck right here. We've got some nyala around us. We haven't seen quarantine come. Feeling in my gut that he's still here. Let's see if that bush buck can't find him for us again. With a bit of luck, pinpoint where he is. So the natural instinct is to want to drive around in here and crash everywhere and go and have a look for this and go and have a look for that. But basically what the bush is telling us right now, and this is what you actually got to listen to, the bush is telling us that there's something disturbing some squirrels in front of us. They only call it predators. We've got prey species of animals around us. Four leopard, the bush buck. We've got a young male leopard in this area who's hungry. We've got decent cover in the form of a drainage line on our right hand side. There's nothing that's telling us that he's moved off. Everything's telling us just to sit tight and have a little bit of patience. Even though, I must be honest, I'm the same as you. I just want to start the car and drive around. We're just going to fight that urge just for a little bit.
I can see the nyala seems to be following the same course as the bushbuck.
So the nyala, Scott has seen, are coming along the same track that the bushbuck is coming on. In other words, right back to where they were originally. Tension that we're feeling is delicious at the moment, I must be honest with you. There just seems to be an energy around here.
They were looking like they were going to pop out in this little gap where I'm waiting, but they've changed their plans.
So thank goodness these animals are not tame. and don't do what you think they're going to do. Otherwise, we'd have very boring lives out here. But now we need to decide what we're going to do. Either we've got a choice to go and have a look what that squirrel's shouting at, which my gut feel tells me is another predator. Or we need to just stick to this drainage line where we lost him and see if he isn't lying up here somewhere. What do you think?
Or the elephants.
Or the elephants.
Too many options.
Too many options. Okay. So it's an easy choice actually. Let's see if we can hear that squirrel still. The squirrel's gone silent. The bushbuck has walked straight past where we last saw quarantine, and therefore he's probably not there. I do think that he's still in this area though. So everyone, I think what we're going to try and do is going to have a look. I can't hear that squirrel anymore, so to try and find one squirrel in one tree in this thick bush is going to be very, very difficult. I think what we're going to do is we're going to go and have a look and see if we can relocate those elephants, which are in exactly the same area. And here, if something else doesn't spook away from quarantine, and it'll give us a precise pinpoint place to start looking from. It worked very well for us the last time. Couple of minutes ago, for those of you who are just joining us, we stopped next to some bushbuck in an area some of our colleagues had seen a male leopard, and out of the grass exploded the bushbuck and exploded the leopard in tow. He missed the bushbuck, but he followed them across the road, and there was nothing suggesting that he was giving up the hunt. We now with the bushbuck, they've walked around us, and we have lost the leopard in this very, very thick bush around us. We're on the edge of a drainage line, which limits our movement to this side. It's way too steep for us to drive down. So we're going to make our way back onto the road. We're going to see if we can find those elephants that are not too far away from here, have a look at them, and at the same time, just listen to the bush around us to see if he has another go at that bush buck. I'm sorry that it was so brief. I'm very glad to say that we got to see a hunting sequence like we did. It was very exciting for the time that we had with him. And I'm glad to see that he's looking in such good condition, barring a bit of an empty belly. Which I'm sure for a leopard won't stay that way for too long. They have an incredibly wide prey range, ranging from fish through insects. I've even seen a male leopard jump onto a giraffe. Of course, he would never be able to kill it, but he took a chance in any case, as amazing as that sounds. I'd like to take the time just to say thank you for the comments on Twitter which identified quarantine. It always helps when you know what animal you're looking for, especially when it comes down to leopards. They are creatures of habit, and you build up an understanding of their personalities, for lack of a better word. And I say that very lightly. There's a danger of some anthropomorphism when you're talking about animals that you get to know from young cubs through to adulthood. They're not human, but they definitely do have habits. In front of us are those Nyala. No sign of any leopard around here. Wash your thorns. Okay. Because essentially what we're doing is finding something interesting to look at while we are listening for this leopard, we're going to take some time to have a look at this Nyala. This is a bull Nyala, as I said. And Nyala are where the separation between bull and cow of the species and ram and ewe happens. This is a Nyala bull, but the females are ewes, which is uncommon. Normally you have either a bull and a cow, a ram and a ewe. These are bulls. They're fully mature. I know they're fully mature. You have a look at their horns. The tips of their horns are white. I'll show you in a second. There we go. And you'll notice that those white tips, when seen together, are parallel with one another. When the horn tips point towards one another, they are juvenile. When they point away from one another, they passed their prime. So these are two bull Nyala in their prime. Prime bulls. These guys will be vying for females. They'll be vying for the attention of females during the breeding season. When you think about two males being with one another, why aren't they fighting? But subtly, they actually are with one another. This Nyala bull is standing side on to us, and you'll notice that that crest of hair that he's got surrounds his entire body. So from his head, the back of his head, all the way down the base of his spine, to his tail, onto his belly, up his neck again. And that is, he can erect those hairs, make himself look much bigger and much more impressive. You can see that he almost wants to, but it's not quite making that crest on his back stand up. And that's because it's not the breeding season at the moment. There's no reason for him to get super angry. Most animals with horns that sharp will avoid fighting with one another if at all possible. And standing, it's called in piloerection, when they have the crest of hair on their body standing up, standing side on with one another, posturing. It's a way for them to assert dominance over the smaller bulls, a way for breeding bulls to stand up. Now, you won't believe it, but we've got an elephant literally 40 yards in front of us, moving quieter through the bush than these two Nyala are. You'll see, coming into the picture, in those green bushes in front of us, is a fully grown elephant. You'll see him stick his head out of the bushes in a second. You can just see his leg in the middle of the screen right now, is that straight line that you're looking at there. Mother Nature very rarely has straight lines. And there we have, voila. You're looking at a 4-ton animal standing in a bush that wouldn't have hidden this Land Rover. Incredible. So let's go around and have a look at this Illy a little bit better. Thank you. So far the bush around us is dead quiet. No alarm calls, no Franklin calling, no bushbuck calling, no more squirrels calling. It seems quarantine has given us the slip. Or he's lying down in the shade somewhere. One of the two. It looks like we have more than one elephant here. Technical difficulty with Scott and I crashing through the bush after quarantine a couple of minutes ago. We managed to kick off a wire, and as robust as what we try and make these systems, unfortunately wires are wires, and there was a loose connection, so we lost you there for a second. But we haven't been totally without hope. We're still with those two young bull elephant that we were with a second or two ago. They're just behind the bush on our left hand side. And we're going to be going, there we go, there's the youngsters, two males. As I was saying just before we lost you, I know they're males because of the domed forehead that they have in profile. Females have a very angular forehead. These are two youngsters, they're definitely not as big as what they could be, although they're still very big. We're looking at about 3 ton here, 2 ton, 2.5, 3 tons. There. So these young guys, quite often at this age, they like older teenagers, and I always like to liken them to teenagers in a shopping center with a family. They have to be at the shopping center because they want the ice cream mommy's gonna buy, but they don't want to walk with you. So these guys are in attendance to a herd. There must be a breeding herd somewhere. They're not old enough to be on their own just yet, but they will be on the periphery. And as such, they look like they are on their own, but they're not. So these young guys can be quite, or have a lack of confidence. They can be quite nervous. And you'll notice that that blowing noise that he just did to us was just an indication of their nerves. They're not scared of us. As you can see, they're still eating. It's a very good sign when elephants are still eating around you. The flapping of the ears has got nothing to do with aggression. It's got mostly to do with just keeping them cool. Elephants pump all their blood in their body through their ears. By flapping them, it cools the blood down and sends it back into the body a little bit cooler. And for warm-blooded animals, you must maintain a set body temperature. It's vital that they have, these large animals have that ability. Now have a look at the bottom of his trunk. You'll notice on the left-hand side, it's a discolored compared to the right hand side. You may or may not have noticed that, and that's because elephants show dimorphism in their action that they eat, similar to the way humans are left or right handed. This elephant is right. You'll see that when he crops the grass, he will always twirl the grass onto the right-hand side of his trunk. What he's doing there is just getting rid of pieces of grass that are not nutritious and sand before he puts it in his mouth. See those fine hairs on his chin? They're not beards, well, I suppose they are beards, but they are there to help feel what he's putting into his mouth. His eyes point towards the tip of his trunk, not forward like we'd think. He's actually looking at the ground there. His trunk is very sensitive on those two lobes at the bottom of his trunk. He knows exactly what he's picking up. Sense of smell is good. And then he has all these sensory organs. I love the way they do that. So you'll notice the way he curls his trunk around the grass. This particular elephant will curl it that way around the grass every single time. And that's what gives the elephant on the right hand side that distinctive discoloration. It's just all the vegetable juices that have stained his trunk there. A trunk is an extension of his top lip and his nose. Now, unlike us, where we can breathe through our mouth or our nose, an elephant can only breathe through their nose. They can't breathe through their mouth. Their mouth is only joined to their tummy and their trunk is only joined to their lungs. Enjoying some grass this late in the season. This is one of the last times, or one of the last months I should say, not times, one of the last months they'll be eating a lot of grass. They'll gradually be shifting their diet from grass to woody species, so trees and roots, over the next couple of months. In summertime, 80% or so of their diet is made up of trees, of grass. In winter, about 80% of their diet is made up of wood and roots, bark, and sticks. See if he flaps his ear. See into his ear hole that sits in front of his ear. That's where his eardrum lies. And an elephant's brain lies directly between the two ears. And you can see the thickness of skull between the front of his head and the ears is an indication of how thick the elephant's skull is. That's all bone. It's a honeycombed bone. And by that I mean it's got all these liquid-filled chambers in it. And it acts as a massive shock absorber. And by shock absorber, when elephant are fighting with one another, bull elephant at some of the most titanic battles that you can get when they're fighting for females, they'll bash heads with one another, running at one another. You need these thick skulls to protect their brains. And elephant bulls also push down a lot of trees. And they need that spongy bone in the front of their head to help cushion blows against trees. Have a look at this. See the ears open? He's trying to make himself look bigger. He's just trying to intimidate us. Not seriously. Almost across the road. Beautiful. He's probably going to give us a little bit of a head shake. There we go. You're a big boy. You know, with elephants, you always got to make them feel like they're big. It definitely helps smooth relations. So, that head up, ears out, is just a way of him trying to make himself look big and scary. You'll notice that he's still eating. That tells me that he's not angry. His tail isn't cocked to the side. That's an indication of discomfort. That's why I'm not reversing as fast as I can away from these guys. And there they move off on their day. Elephants always look like they're wearing baggy pajamas when they're walking off. Now, elephants are hind gut fermented. And by that I mean their digestive system is such that they can really take a lot of nutrients out of the grass and out of bushes of a variety of different quality types. They don't necessarily only have to eat the best quality food that's available. Their digestive system is geared to taking nutrition out of any type of food. And because of that, they've got a digestion that requires constant input. Food is constantly going in and constantly coming out. And although their digestive system can take nutrients out of almost anything, it's quite inefficient at taking all the nutrients out of what they're eating. Hence, the need to just eat and eat and eat. They spend, in this time of the year, 16 to 20 hours a day eating. Which is a lot, actually, considering. To their ear, even though you very often see injuries to ears. So, the answer from my experience is no. As to why that is, I would say it's because they've got such big flappy ears. Mother Nature has already provided for that. Are we going to hang around with these two young boys? They don't seem to be worried about us at all, giving us nice insight into the lives of young bull elephants or teenagers. It's amazing how quick these guys can actually move through the bush. How quietly they can move through the bush. Watch your thorns. The reason why I want to stay in this area with these elephants is obviously they're nice to look at, but equally so, I haven't forgotten the fact that we've still got quarantine somewhere close by, and we're using this opportunity to listen to the bush around us once again. Coming back to the fact that the bush tells a story constantly. And if you're aware of what it's trying to tell you, the options are almost limitless for what you can get up to out here. A young bull elephant like this will be in association for the herd for a few more years, and then they move off in search of bachelor herds. You very often find young bulls a little bit older than this joining very old bulls, and their wanderings take them very far from the natal range. Out of focus for those of you just catching that cocktail. That was just him telling us he didn't appreciate us bashing the tree down like we did. They're busy wrestling, or it could have been the fact that they're just wanting to have a bit of a play fight with one another, which is actually probably the case. These young guys have got a lot of energy to expend. Quite often play fights erupt at the most weird moments, while they're having a bath, while they're drinking, while they're eating. So coming back to the story about these guys, will eventually join up with probably an older bull elephant who's not going from breeding herd to see if there's any females ready for him. And it takes them for years out of the system. Now, older bull elephants suppress sexual maturity in young bull elephant. In a park in South Africa called the Pilansberg National Park, they reintroduced young bull elephant and no old elephant. And what happened was chaos. Young bull elephant with no older mature bulls around turned into rogue elephant. And damaged property, killed rhinoceros, were killing buffalo, and it stopped when they reintroduced some old Kruger bulls into the Pilansberg. It just reinforced some discipline. I'm going to try get in front of these ellies. They are going down into some thick riverine bush. They're probably making their way to some water. Elephants will drink at least once a day.
Now they could come down this path, I guess, but their last track seem to be that they were heading. Yeah.
You know, once again, my predictions about what animals are going to do is absolutely turned on its head by the fact that they are their own animals and will do what they want to do when they want to do it. Not when I want to do it. Ah, there we go. So when you're approaching elephants, never really a good idea to approach them directly or head on. They don't like it too much. You've got to stroke the egos of these elephants. It's important, as I mentioned a bit, to let them believe that they're still the biggest things in the bush. That way you avoid nasty confrontations. So eating humble pie around elephants is often one of the best ways of getting close to them, especially bull elephant. So you'll notice him now stretching into the trees, using his trunk to reach into a bush. He doesn't have to crash into the trees, even though he's fully capable of ripping that tree out by the roots. The trunk of his extends his reach by almost half of his body length. And allows him to feed to a height higher than that of a giraffe bull when he is fully mature. He will reach 5.5 meters into the air when he's mature. Once again, just pointing out how thick that skull is. If you have a look at the ear hole and the thickness of skull from the front of the head, their brain lies just behind their ear hole. Their ear hole is sort of in the middle of their brain. Their brain is about as big as a volleyball, maybe a little bit smaller than a volleyball. So a lot of skull, and that's for when they fight with one another. See how still he got there? So that stillness is typical of an elephant that's busy hearing something. Elephants are large enough to produce ultra low frequency noises, infrasound. Now, infrasound is below the level that we can hear, but is a very effective way of communicating through the bush. Research has shown that elephants will react to other elephants calling up to 10 kilometers away, roughly 6 miles away, by using these ultra low frequency noises. Mm-hmm. So don't worry, folks. It's just a young teenager just letting us know what he thinks about us. Once again, we didn't move, we didn't scream, and we didn't shout. We just want to let him know that we respect him. He is big. It's always best to tell them that every now and again. And I want to leave them with the same sense of peace that they've left us. Once again, impressed at the way that they just blend into the bush. There's one scraggly little bush between us and that elephant. He's about 15 meters in front of us and you can hardly see him. Welcome. Hello, Jeffrey. You asked a nice question. Do elephants have a distinct smell? And if they do have a distinct smell, is it a bad smell? And I have to say the answer to that question is yes, sometimes. Is it overwhelming? Can we smell these elephants from where we are? No, they are basically scentless, except for when they exhale out of their trunk. It's a very herby smell. Their breath has an incredibly herby smell. And I liken it to a herbal toothpaste. I know it sounds a bit weird, but a herbal toothpaste has that quite herby smell, and that's what an elephant's breath smells like. Then when elephant bulls go into a state of must, elephant bulls have an adaptation where their testosterone levels increase up to 70%. And this allows mature bulls to vie one another, vie with one another for the favors of a female. And it's an evolutionary adaptation which helps elephant, not all the male elephants in one particular area to converge at the same time on one cow. It would be too much. It would be overwhelming for that particular elephant or for that female. And so elephant only, they themselves, their bodies go into a heightened state. A couple of times a year, depending on the elephant. Some elephant have it for up to 170 days a year. Other elephant have it in patches through the year. And this particular heightened state, this must condition that they go into, and this testosterone level increase makes all the glands in their body work overtime. And they produce a lot of smell at this particular point. A mutts, bull, elephant, even to humans, the smell is sickly sweet, is what I like to liken it to. It's something that you can't really describe. It's a smell that is unmistakable once you've smelt it once, and lingers for many days on the path that that particular bull elephant has been walking on. He basically just drips glandular secretions that have this smell. So the answer to your question is yes. So the bush around us is still remarkably quiet. We've had no further sign that quarantine has managed to catch or kill one of those nyala or the bushbuck that we were looking at. We've heard no alarm calls. We've got no evidence that there's any squirrels calling. I've heard no Franklins, nothing whatsoever to let me know where he is. What we're going to do though is we're going to go back into the or onto the road where we saw him run across chasing that bushbuck a little bit earlier and see if he isn't lying up close to the road. Otherwise, what we're going to do is circle the area and see if he hasn't moved out of the area, and we can pick up some alarm calls and in a slightly different zone, a slightly wider search area, and we're going to pick it up from there. So we're going to leave these elephants. I thank them very much for allowing us to stay in the area of quarantine and also for sharing some of their day with us, and I wish them luck. Hopefully they find their mommies before it gets dark and they get scared. Notice as I'm driving through the bush, I put the trees that we... I try and miss trees as much as what I can, but when it's unavoidable, I try and put the tree in the middle of the car. There's a plate at the bottom of these cars, which is sloped at an angle which allows us to push the tree down gently, and it springs back up underneath the car. There are trees that we don't drive over whatsoever. Trees that are very rigid, we don't drive over, and trees that are rare and uncommon, we don't drive over. We only drive over those trees that have the ability to spring up behind the car. They tend to be quite hardy. The acacia species of trees out here are definitely show no ill effects. And we are very sensitive about where we drive and where we don't drive in the bush. A lot of the training that guides go through is in reading the bush around you and to try and read where you can and where you can't drive and in what different seasons, what trees you can drive over, what trees you can't. We spent months learning the differences between these before we allowed anywhere close to cars. To go The other way around this termite mound, we were snookered by some fallen down branches. Is it curry that I picked yesterday?
Oh yeah.
Female elephant can fall pregnant from about 5, and they're pregnant for 22 months. It's a long time, a long gestation period. And see, well, I don't know if you were part of the show earlier this morning. We were talking about hyena and other predators who get rid of their babies in litters and in dens and in safekeeping after a very short gestation period, and they have usually more than one cub because of this. But elephant usually only have one baby. It's not uncommon for them to have twins, but by all means, elephant as much as any animal can have twins, but generally speaking it's just one baby at a time that's held within the mother for a very long period of time, 22 months. And what that means is the little one, when it's born, is born with its eyes open, it's born able to stand a couple of minutes after birth, it's born able to even feed itself from its mother within a couple of hours after birth. And it just helps, it gives that little guy just a better chance of surviving. Our tire's looking on that side.
Got two on this side.
No, all good.
So, I suppose I asked a pretty random question to Scott to check if we have any punctures after driving through the bush like that. It's always good to check your tires. And I asked him how our tires were, and he replied that we've got two tires on that side of the car, which is a good thing to know after crashing through the bush like we did. Looking on the left, this is where we last saw quarantine. You can see the drainage line, the incredibly thick bush that we lost him in. He was last seen moving into this bush after a bush buck that we kept in sight for a good 20 minutes without seeing him again. Now, there were some squirrels calling in front of us. I'm going to be making our way towards that area, or in that direction, just in case he decided to move past the bushbuck. He is a young leopard, and that was a fully grown bushbuck, and it may have just been a little bit out of his range, out of his comfort zone to tackle. Bushbuck males like that, or that size, are formidable opponents, and he might have gone in search of some easier prey. I have to say thank you to everyone who's sending the messages via Final Control, and thank you very much for your support during this drive. It means a lot to me, and it means a lot to the crew. Thank you very much for your feedback. It's quite special. So what I'm doing is I'm checking the sandy patches of this road. This is in the vector that in this direction.
Yeah, Steph. Or is that how you know?
Yeah, that's him, mate. So I think it's worth showing you what we're talking about.
Perfect.
In front of us is the tracks of a leopard. I'm going to get out and show you with my finger. And this is exactly what we were looking for. This is confirmation that he came out onto the road. Tell me which track you're looking at. These ones here?
Yeah. If you go forward a little bit to the next one, it's a bit better.
This one here?
Yeah.
Or these here?
Yeah, those ones there, it's tricky.
But nevertheless, it's going to be difficult to show you the exact detail around these tracks just because the camera rig on the vehicles is static and it's quite solid. But this here is where he walked. They sets of two tracks at a time. Half a meter apart from one another, left hand side of his body, right hand side of his body. You could almost see how he was walking down the road very slowly. This is his front foot, this is his back foot. Leopard often imprint, which means that the front foot should be covered by the back foot. Now he's been walking down this road quite slowly. We can see both pads, means that he's taking his time, giving us the slip. Obviously that bushbuck was a little bit big for him, and the squirrel that was calling in this area was calling at him. So there you go. Sometimes the interpretation of the newspaper is not as good as what you hope it can be. So we'll carry on going and we'll see if we can track him down. So after having his first go, my interpretation of this whole thing is after having his first go at that bushbuck, he decided that it was a little bit too much for him. He walked around the bushbuck and the nyala so that he avoided being seen and therefore them giving further alarm calls into the bush and announcing his presence, and he just moved after easier prey. He just went to go look for easier prey. So testimony again to how intelligent these animals are. Even at such a young age and with the experience that he's got, he's able to know when a fight is a little bit out of his weight category. His tracks are still on the road. We come into a junction in the road. We'll now see whether he turned left, right, or he went straight. Do something else, check for tracks in the sand. This bush track down here. Let's go check the bush track. So it looks like it didn't come, or it didn't carry on going straight. Thank you. So it looked like he either went straight into the bush or he turned down this road. Let's see. My gut feel is telling me because we're not finding any tracks on the road that he just went straight into the bush there. But let's go and have a look just a little bit further down this road for some tracks. And then we'll turn around and we'll carry on going straight. Parallel to where he's walking. This road is quite difficult to see tracks on, it's covered in grass. And there's not a lot of sand on it. Nevertheless, even though I don't have any tracks on this road, I'm going to turn around and I'm going to go parallel to the direction that he was heading in. He's heading straight north. Leopard quite often will walk in a direction. In this particular case, he's walking north. And it doesn't matter what's in front of them, they'll carry on going north, even though they have slight detours and slight hunting, for instance, or marking some territory or going for a drink, but they'll carry on going north for a bit. And what I'm making my decision on is the fact that knowing that that's the behavior of leopard, that he's going to carry on going north. And so what we're going to do is find roads that are going north and then crisscrossing east and west, cross that path to see if he comes out onto that road. Essentially, I'm giving away all my tricks over here. And while we're looking for confirmation of the direction that he's gone, we will then be equally listening for any of the telltale signs, warning signs, etc. So I think that he moved off in this direction. Leopard will drink when there's water around. It's not a necessity though. They get all the moisture that they need from their prey. So it's not to say that because there's water in front of him that he's making his way down to water. And with the temperature picking up, he may or may not go and lie down. Leopard are funny things. You sometimes find them walking. Another youngster. Beautiful coat pattern, that rusty color. Welcome back, everybody. Sorry, we're still having these lingering faults coming from our encounter in the bush a bit earlier. So please bear with us and accept our apology. What we have done is we found a road that is running east-west across where quarantine tracks were last coming. And both Scott and myself predict that if he's not still in the block on our left-hand side, then he's going to come out onto this road with the potential of heading towards Vuyatela Dam, which will be a focal point for a lot of animals going for a drink. And for a leopard who's as hungry as what he is, that would be akin to us going to the supermarket. So we're going to check this road. It's not ideal for tracks, as you can see in front of me on the road there. The surface is quite hard. Not very good for showing the imprint of a light animal. Many of you would have noticed over the last days the infestation of flies that the Sabi Sands has experienced. Now, every year seems to bring on a new insect plague that happens at some point during the season. And this year it just so happens to be these tiny little flies that are in their absolute thousands swarming around us. It's quite an effort not to continually just smack ourselves in the face and brush these flies off. I'm sure you've wondered why Scott and Brent haven't brushed flies off their faces. There he is there. We've managed to relocate him. So congratulations to the tracking 101. Trailing 101, I should say. So folks, in a perfect world, that's how easy it is. And believe me, I think it's beginner's luck mostly. So lying up in the shade, I presume it's the same leopard. Very difficult for me to tell at this angle, male from female. I can tell you that it's a young kid.
Morning, Aubrey.
Morning,
folks. How are you doing?
Hello, everybody. How are you?
Being covered in I want to say thank you to our viewers once again. We've just confirmed using spot pattern analysis that this is quarantine. So absolutely the same cat as we were having a look at just now.
found after a little bit of intuitive tracking and understanding the habits of these animals, I must say that we made it look a bit easier than what it actually was. And I do have to pat myself and Scott in the back there and say thank you very much for that. So we do have another vehicle in the sighting with us. Aubrey, come in for a step. Aubrey, if you wouldn't mind taking over this lock, I'm going to be in it. I'm busy with the radio. If you wouldn't mind taking over the lock for me. Well, folks, what a fantastic way to end today's drive. It started off this morning in the mist. It's my first drive. It was beautiful. We decided to go and have a look at the hyena den to go and see what happened to the hyenas who got attacked by the wild dogs yesterday, or had a scrap with the wild dogs. I'm happy to report that they're all in very good condition. The cubs are fine. They were playing around the vehicle. They were suckling from their mothers. We had some interaction of other hyenas moving into the den site, and a bit of submissive behavior going on, which is very interesting to see. We got to see a hyena pasting on a piece of grass, which is very rare to see. It's uncommon to see. We then moved away from that area and came and gave some of our colleagues a hand finding Quarantine, young male leopard that we currently with, and in the middle of where we were standing, he burst out of the bush chasing a bush buck with elephants standing around, Nyala standing around. We then lost him for a while, took our time watching two young male elephant just feeding through the bush slowly, and then myself and Scott decided to put our brains to finding where Quarantine went, as he was quite clearly not with us at that moment. And as luck would have it, beginner's luck would have it, and I thank all the energy that you've been sending through to us over Twitter and emails, and it was that, I feel, that was the deciding factor. We've now bumped into Quarantine again, lying right next to the road, and we're going to end the show saying thank you very much from Scott and myself, and from Nikki in Final Control. Thank you very much for all your questions and your help with IDing this animal. And we're going to end the show with a nice look at the young male leopard, Quarantine. And we'll see you this afternoon. Thank you very much.